Welcome to Straight Talk for Women Only. I'm Judy.
I'm Mary.
And I'm Chanel.
And we're here to talk to you tonight about getting rid of fear, worry, and anxiety. These are three things that can plague your life and really immobilize you to where you feel like you can't do anything that you would normally do. You can't have fun, you can't relax, because these three issues have constantly got a hold.
Right.
And tonight we want to find out how to break this, because God did not design us to live in fear.
Right, exactly.
He didn't design us to live in worry or anxiety. And the reason we know that is because there are specific times in the Word of God that He addresses each of these issues, some by a command, some by admonishing us, encouraging us, but we know God does not want us living like this. So Mary's going to start off.
You're afraid.
In the name of Jesus,
be healed, be delivered, and set free. Help me, Jesus. Hallelujah. Well, let me just tell you what fear is, according to definition. It says, fear is a distressing emotion aroused by impending danger, evil, pain, or some other threat, real and or imagined.
Absolutely.
You know, that's what they say with fear. Fear is like false evidence appearing real.
Mm-hmm.
Fear is like a clogging of your, clogging your faith. It's faith versus fear. Either you have faith or you have fear.
Right.
And when you have fear, you're, false evidence appearing real. It's something you believe and it's not true necessarily. It's not, it's a lie. It's something that you're imagining, as it says. You can imagine it, or something that's happening right then and there.
Right.
You know, you may see a car coming and just crossing the street, and all of a sudden you get this thing, it's going to hit you. Fear. And there's good fear and there's bad fear.
Oh, that's okay. So explain what the good fear is.
Well, the good fear is when it's a word for it, and I don't remember the word, but most people know that it's flight or flee. I think it's something like that, that's that good fear.
Right.
For instance, if I see a car coming and it's getting a little bit closer, I'm going to start running across the street.
Right.
You know, you need to use
wisdom
for that impact
or
to happen.
Or if there's a man following you.
Right.
And you're walking along and you can feel that somebody's behind you.
Right. Then you might want
to
let you know something ain't right. So you will do something different to cancel that void, fear out completely.
Right.
So, again, that fear is what? Impending danger, that's an impending danger, evil, pain, or some other threat, or real and or imagined. Now, so a lot of things can put us in fear. We can get a doctor's report that could put you in fear, make you start making, you know, plans for your death, you know, because you're in fear now, not in faith. You can be in fear of financial situation, relationships, marriage, children, dreams, visions not being fulfilled. There's a lot of young women that are reaching that age where they want to have babies, and they're in fear that, you know, they're never going to get married before they're able to have, you know, children.
Mm-hmm.
So there's so many things we can have fear in, real and or imagined, impending or, you know, coming, something we believe.
Mm-hmm.
So what I wanted to basically say about fear, and I took some notes on it, I didn't want to, you know, be too long on it, but Satan wants to, again, to build a wall of fear in our minds, what? To immobilize our faith, stop us from taking possession of our promises.
Mm-hmm.
And this is talking about the bad fear, because we know there's a good fear. You know, I remember one time when I was in Poland, I was preaching, and my title of my message was The Fear of the Lord.
Mm-hmm.
And they had to let me know the fear of the Lord to them was like being afraid,
right,
instead of being a reverential.
Right.
Fear. So I had to change the word reverential, you know, reverence.
Referencing the
fear,
Lord versus being scared.
Scared. We don't want to be
right.
So that's how they knew fear.
Right.
But there's like, again, the fear of flight or flee, or, you know. I know one time I said this about, I know somebody is doing some really deep stuff, and he's a Christian, and really doing some stuff. I was telling James, I don't know, I just would be afraid to be doing that. I mean, once you know the Lord in a certain way, there's certain things you just don't want to do. Because,
which is that reverence.
Right, that reverential fear.
Like, I have a fear of not obeying Him.
Right.
It's like I couldn't hear God speak to me and me just totally
ignore
what He's saying.
Right.
That is like I don't want to ever do that.
Right, exactly.
So that's the
reverential fear.
You don't want to disappoint him. You know, you want to always be in his will.
Right.
And, you know, continue to have his grace and favor on your life. So that fear promotes you being obedient to him in out of love.
Right, right. Exactly.
But you don't live every day saying, oh, I'm so afraid of God. Did I fail you? Did I do anything wrong? Did I sin?
Right, that's when it becomes negative.
Right. Yeah.
It's a negative type of a fear. So it, again, stops us from taking possession of the promise of God, stops us from doing the works of God, and stops us from operating the gifts of the Spirit. So what does God say about fear? In Romans 8:15, for you have not received what?
The spirit of fear.
Again, but to fear, but you have received the spirit of adoption, where we cry out, Abba Daddy, Father God, Abba Father. As believers, we are adopted sons, so we need to not be enslaved to sin or fear. So instead of being enslaved to fear, enslaved, like you're a slave of fear, false evidence appearing real, things looking and imagined that it's not going to work. What am I going to do? I don't know. And God's already given us his words, what he has already done.
Right. Exactly. You know what? I have a question. I just thought of this. What about people that have had something really bad happen to them?
Oh, trauma.
And then for the rest of their lives, they're so afraid that's going to happen again.
Yeah.
Like not getting married because they had a bad marriage.
Right.
And I'm afraid. I'm afraid of that.
That's a good one. Because I had a fear.
Yes.
Of being married again. I mean, after being married the first time, and it wasn't very nice. It was, you know, pretty abusive. And finally got out of it, you know. And after that, it was like, hey, whew, that's it for the kid. Not no more. Nuh-uh. And I mean, you know, I've dated and whatnot, but as far as getting married again, it was like, forget that. That is not happening. Because
I
can relate to was the fact that this is, after the I do, they all changed up on me. What in the world? So fear.
Right.
Fear of being married. So I had to get set free and delivered from that. Because you're right. And there's a lot of women I know personally that went through that stage or are going through that, you know, stage.
And it stops God's promises.
Exactly.
You know, if you've had a situation where, I know one time I had a situation where I was mugged. A man followed me and he jumped on me, on top of me. I can still right now see his face on top of me as he was trying to get my purse. That's what he was trying to do.
Mm-hmm.
But if I, every night, lived in fear of that happening again,
Right.
And I rushed home before it got dark, and I closed up all my windows and my blinds. That definitely is living in fear and not overcoming.
There's so much of that.
It
is unbelievable how you speak to people after a while. I never forget. I was a girlfriend of mine's daughter was taking her out to eat, and we was in the car together. And she had we were talking, and it was something that was causing her to have. What do they call those, when you get those attacks?
Panic attack?
No, panic?
Not panic.
Seizures.
Oh,
seizures.
Okay.
So I don't know, I just started talking to her, and I started talking to her about what was the greatest thing that ever put fear in you? And so she automatically started talking about when her and her mother was in the car. And when they were in this car, they went into this ditch, and they got stuck in this ditch. And they got stuck in this ditch for hours.
Mm.
And so I said, okay. And then I knew how to pray.
Right.
And so I prayed on it. Do you know when we went into the bathroom of the restaurant, she had a seizure in the bathroom?
Wow.
And immediately, you know, took authority and whatnot. But that's where she went. And that was years ago.
Right.
So there are a lot of things that people, like for instance, I was talking earlier about, I had a fear of mice. I don't like them little things. They were powerful woman, brave, whatever. My husband always say, scared of a little mouse. I said, yeah, that's right. Mm-hmm. That little old mouse.
So I don't think any woman likes a mouse.
No, none of us do. A mouse would run across this carpet right now. I'm pretty
sure we'd be all on these chairs.
On that table. Yeah.
Because I remember when I was young, and we had to take turns washing dishes in the kitchen.
Mm-hmm.
And I remember I used to always pay my sister at least a quarter, 50 cents. And I said, please, when it was my turn to wash dishes. Because every time we would be standing there at the sink washing dishes, it was this little mouse that would go through.
Oh, my goodness.
And I would just freeze. I'm just so scared.
when the reality of it, what can this little teeny thing do to us?
I had no clue, but I knew that I was afraid.
I don't know.
I moved out of a whole house when I was stationed in England. They had a
mouse.
Oh, it was a mouse. I moved back on the base. They didn't want to hear about no lease. I said, I didn't have no mice with sign no lease for mice.
Right.
So I'm out of here.
It wasn't me and no mice moving in.
I'm back
mice ain't paying no rent, right?
So there's all kinds of fears and phobias and things that we get because we never get set free and delivered out of fear.
Mm-hmm.
Because, again, I got delivered to be able to get married again. As far as seeing a mouse, I haven't been tested yet, but I'm sure that I will do a lot better. Because I will, in the name of Jesus, you have another. But I think I'm a lot better than I was. I mean, or I tell you another time I had fear grip me. I mean, really grip me. I was in the bed sleeping. And James was out because he was working that night. And all of a sudden I heard this crash downstairs. And I jumped up. Heart. I mean, if my heart had a weak heart, I probably would have died that night. Because it was, I can hear it coming out of my chest. Boom, 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 boom,
oh
boom,
God,
boom,
yeah.
Boom, boom. I got up and I grabbed my .38 that I have permission to have.
I was about to say, Pastor Mary's packing.
Her legal.
My legal.
.38.
That's right.
So
my
I
sister Carrie.
Go to the door and I shut it, lock it, and I come back and sit down on the bed. Sitting there now waiting. If they stayed downstairs, they should live and not die. They came up them steps.
You don't
had to
know.
Do some serious praying.
Oh, my goodness.
Because they came through that door, Jesus. I didn't know what I would do, but I tell you, my heart was skipping out of my chest. Bottom line, nothing happened.
Right.
So I calmed down because I was just so sleepy. And I didn't want to be calling no police officers, you know, and getting them, you know,
so you didn't go downstairs to check?
I didn't go to check. I didn't go to look. If they wanted the whole house,
did
they
you lock your door?
I locked my door.
Yeah.
The door was locked. Mm-hmm. I had my safety measure.
Right.
Then I had Jesus.
That's all you
so
needed.
I kept my peace.
Right.
After my heart stopped racing. And then James came in that morning, right? And he seen this big picture that fell on the floor. And the first thing he says, oh, Lord. He knew that.
He knew that it would scare too.
Yeah, he knew. He knew
that if it was still there, you probably was in fear a little bit.
Yeah.
There.
Oh yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. He knew I was well prepared too. So
right.
He was feeling for the person.
One time, I was in my house in Philly, and I kept hearing this knock, 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 knock. It just kept, and I was going through the house, and all of a sudden, I came into the kitchen, and the door that led to the basement, I could mm-hmm. see the door coming out, and I thought, my God, somebody's down in our basement.
Mm-hmm.
So I went up and got a gun.
Mm-hmm.
It was a gun, though, that Liz,
right.
my sister-in-law, had, and she lived with us. And I got the gun. Well, I had never probably even held a gun, let alone use it. So I'm waving it all over the place.
Oh,
and
Lord, that's the worst thing you can
and
do.
And we called the police, too,
right,
in the meantime.
Right.
But I had that gun, and we went to the door, opened it, and it was the cat.
Oh, my God.
Knocking on the door.
Yeah.
But see, false evidence appearing real.
Well, that's what that alarm went off at the very house that the very first house I lived in. The alarm went real fast. Alarm went off. Same thing. Got the gun. I did call the police. And they said, ma'am. I said, ma'am, I am fine. As long as he stays downstairs and I'm upstairs. Because I didn't have a lock on this door. It was one of those open,
oh,
you know.
Yeah.
So I'm upstairs. And they said, ma'am, don't do nothing. Just we're sending someone over now. Blah, blah, blah. Time the police officers got there, she was on the phone with me, and she said, they're down at the door. You can go down to the door and answer it now.
Mm-hmm.
She knew my name. She knew I had a registered gun. She knew where I worked. They had the whole sheet
uh-huh.
on me before they even came over to the house.
Oh, wow.
Isn't that something?
Right.
Yeah, so I went down. And they said the wind just blew the alarm.
Wow.
So there's all kinds of things that can frighten us, but again, it's flight or flee. And it depends on the type of fright or type of fear. We can, like I said, live in fear all of our lives and ruin our future because mm-hmm. of something that happened in the past, as you know, you said earlier.
And I think sometimes you have to overcome that. Well, you're going to tell us how to overcome the fear.
Yeah. Some of the causes of fear is, again, trusting in the arms of flesh, accepting negative information from the natural environment, which is reports of insufficient checkbook, mm-hmm. maybe balance, and negative news on TV. Negative news will put you mm-hmm. in fear. You better start believing what thus saith the Lord, because mm-hmm. there's nothing but bad news all over the place. Shootings, bombs, terror attacks, you know, another one of the cores reacting from our senses in our lives, as we see many, many examples of the sensory reactions, which induces fear, such as seeing things in the news, the collapse of a skyscraper, hearing screaming people and sirens, smelling smoke, touching unusual, large,
Yeah, feel something in your body that's strange or new.
Right.
Or
fear. Yeah. You're already dead. You already got your.
Yeah.
It's just, it doesn't take much.
You're already planning your own funeral.
Yeah, it's just evil, entertaining evil imageries, causing an evil spirit to produce imagery in your mind or your imagination. Those are just some of the causes of fear. Well, how do you overcome fear? Well, you can overcome fear by, number one, just trusting in the Word of God, acknowledging God in all your ways. You really have to, God says in His Word, it says He's not giving us a spirit of fear, but of love, power, and sound mind. Perfect love, what is perfect love? Perfect love is casts out all fear. So perfect love is really yielding and submitting to what God says, what God has, done for us in His wisdom and His ways. Mm-hmm. So if fear is coming on me, if God is a covenant of the author of marriage, and I have a fear of being married, and God's plans for me to be married, mm-hmm. then I have to overcome that fear. Mm-hmm. I knew this girl that had a fear of flying. God called her to missions. And
she can't get on a plane.
She can't go on a plane. God had to get her set free from that in order for her to fulfill the call. She flies all over the place now.
Right.
Another girl, just real quick, she had a fear of going down the escalator. She went up. She wouldn't go down. I said, well, because she was like standing there when we was getting ready to go down, and she was going to take the elevator. I said, what are you doing? We're all going down. She said, oh, no, I'll take the elevator. And I said, but you came up, but you're not going down? That's the easy part, going
down.
Right.
So, no. I said, girl, you going down this escalator today? I said, take my arm. She took my arm, told the other girl, take her arm. Come on. So we had to pull him. So she went down. She called me up a week later, and she said, I got free. She said, I'm all up and down the elevators and escalators in the mall now, in the stores. Because that thing had to be broken.
Right.
Whatever happened for her going up, to this day, I don't know. But for some reason, she had it. This could have been something that happened when she was a little girl. Mm-hmm. Things grow up with people. Mm-hmm. And when they grow up with you, and you don't get rid of it, overcome it. Just like people have a fear of going over the bridge, mm-hmm. The Memorial Bridge. I knew this one girl, we were driving. She said, it was almost an anxiety attack. Mm-hmm. You take that one on. And she was, I said, what's wrong with you, girl? What? She says, no, let's turn back. I said, what are you talking about? I can't do it. I can't. I said, you can't do what? What are you saying? I just can't. I can't go over the bridge. I said, okay. So I didn't, I just let it go, turn around. But see, that would be a stopgate for her in many ways. What happens if, she's got to go over somebody's bridge somewhere along the line?
Right,
and
that's
true. It's what controls you,
mm-hmm.
because we're to be controlled by the Holy Spirit,
right?
Be controlled by the will of God, God's purpose for us. But if something else is controlling you,
right,
to where you're immobilized,
exactly.
by that thing,
gotta
and
break.
Speaking
that thing.
Of being immobilized, I mean, I've listened to you ladies talk about moments that you've had in fear, mice and being mugged and those kind of things. There is something that I've been dealing with pretty much all my life, and I'm thinking, am I afraid of anything? I'm not afraid of anything, but I'm sitting here and I'm thinking.
Mm-hmm.
I actually suffer from a condition called sleep paralysis, and I don't know if you've ever heard of it before. Well, it is a condition where periodically I will go to sleep, and I'm in, what is that deep cycle of sleep? It's called REM.
REM
sleep. Mm-hmm. But when something tries to jolt me out of REM and I try to get back into, I guess, the initial stage of sleep, and it's not progressive, my whole body becomes paralyzed and I cannot move.
Wow.
It is the scariest thing ever in the world to me. It just happened to me 2 months. The last time I had an episode was about 2 months ago. And I've been experiencing this since I was about 7 or 8 years old. Had no idea what it was. Now, I'm awake. Mm-hmm. Mentally, I know my body's awake. I can't move my body.
You're immobilized.
At all. I'm completely immobilized. Wow. And it takes a few moments for that, I guess, that sleep cycle to understand that she's not in REM anymore, that she's awake. But for many, many years, I didn't know what was causing this. I didn't know it was a condition. I didn't know that other people were suffering from it. It wasn't until maybe a couple of years ago where I looked it up.
Mm-hmm.
It's not dangerous. It's not, you know, anything I need to go to the doctors about. And, mm-hmm. you know, some people who have certain medical conditions may be more susceptible to it, which is probably why I have sleep paralysis periodically. It happens every now and again. And when my husband first noticed it, he was scared to death, because what I can do when I'm paralyzed in my sleep, I can moan. I can't talk, but I can moan. So I was moaning and moaning and moaning, trying to get him, like, if somebody touches me, I'll instantly pop out of it.
Mm-hmm.
And so,
to get him to touch you.
He was like, "What is going on with you?" Like, are you? I said, "You know, I go through this paralysis thing every now and again. It's not scary, you know. Just when I go through it, just touch me, and I'll wake right up."
Mm-hmm.
So it happened a couple of months ago, and I feel panicky when I'm going through it. Every time I go through it, I feel panicky. I feel fear, and then when he touches me and I jump out of it, I'm hyperventilating. I'm sitting up, and then I laugh at myself, and then it's over. But it took years to come to that.
Sounds almost like an anxiety attack. Right in your sleep.
It's called sleep paralysis because
I'm.
Yeah, you can look it up. It's a lot of people that actually suffer from it, and I didn't think. I thought I was in this thing by myself.
And there's nothing you can do about it?
Mm-mm. No, it's just that I'm trying to jolt myself out of that deep mental realm sleep into waking up.
Well,
and the body's not ready for that.
Well, it's that deep mental realm.
Right.
Some people never get into that really deep sleep.
Exactly.
Really?
And I remember that night, the last time it happened, I was in a deep sleep. And I don't know what made me want to jump up. But when I tried to jump up, the body wasn't ready, like it wasn't catching up. We in a deep, dead sleep right now. I know your mind wants to get up, but your body doesn't want to get up.
Wow.
It's the weirdest thing. It is the scariest thing. But thank goodness I got some education on it that I know it's not,
you know,
detrimental to my
fatal
health or anything.
Or,
right, exactly. But I had to coach my mind to let myself know, because I'm like, what is wrong with me? Am I going to be paralyzed? Am I ever going to wake up? Like, some of the things that are going through my mind while I'm in these, like, it's really moments. It's just it's not even minutes. It's seconds before I can jump up.
It seems like a long time.
It seems like a long time. Like, I need physical touch in order to get me out of it or.
Right.
I don't know, it may take longer to get out of it. You know, I've never.
So what happens if nobody touches you?
Yeah.
I've been by myself and nobody touched me.
Wondering.
Like, when I first experienced it when I was 9, the way I would sleep, my legs were not touching. And I'm fighting to get out of this state. And slowly but surely, I was able to inch my legs back together. And soon as the friction between both legs touched, I was out of it.
Wow.
Had you ever tried to talk? Pray.
I can't. What do you mean while I'm in it?
Right.
I can't
do anything. But you know that you're awake.
I know I'm awake. Oh, I know.
That
I'm well aware that I'm awake.
You know what that sounds like.
I am.
That's
I
what the name they gave it. I got another name for it.
What is that?
I'll tell you later.
She'll tell me off camera. Continue.
Because I went through the same exact thing.
See Mary.
That's right. Same exact thing.
Maybe a follow-up show. I don't know. But
I want to get into it because we're talking about other things here.
Yeah,
but,
okay.
Definitely, we'll talk about it.
All right, amen.
Yeah.
Amen. But that is one of my fears.
Yeah,
the time when I am the most scared.
Yeah,
because
I wrote it down as one of my prayer things years ago. That was a fear of mine. Because the same, I couldn't move. I was in a trance. I knew I wasn't sleeping.
Right.
But I literally could not move. Right. I didn't put all those names you just put on it.
I was just excited that I found an answer to it.
I found
paralysis in like 2 million people.
I didn't find all that. I found the demon.
All right.
And I prayed that thing and prayed. And I found out that those things, I'll talk to you later.
Amen.
Get into it on here.
Okay, let's get back to the show at hand.
Yeah.
But you got set free.
Oh, yeah, I got set free from that mess because it's very scary. When you know. Did you know that you're awoke and you can't move?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, I've been there. That thing scared me. I used to pray about it and
terrifying.
Pray about it. And then I found out what it was and got free from it.
Okay. Mm. Amen.
Get your talk.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Okay,
Hallelujah.
So
the next topic.
Your next topic is?
Worry. Now, just, you know, talking to the viewing audience. All of us at some point in time are going to experience these emotions. We will have worry. We will have fear periodically. We will have anxiety periodically. But like we said, when it becomes something that turns into days and weeks and months, and it's this heaviness that you can't break, that's when you truly absolutely need to be delivered and set free in some kind of, you're in some kind of a bondage. So the definition of worry is a state of unease that allows one's mind to constantly dwell on difficulties and troubles. Just you're afraid of, you know, how you gonna pay your finances? You know, is my kid going to make it to school? They're walking to school by themselves. Are they gonna get off the bus? You know, is, you know, from the most minute things mm-hmm. to the most critical things, so that 9 times out of 10 probably will not come to fruition.
It's almost interchangeable with fear.
It's all tied together.
Worry, 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 worry.
Just worry, worry. I actually have a coworker, and I love her to life.
Mm-hmm.
You know, old coworker, love her to life. Mm-hmm. She is the most worrisome person that I've ever met in my life. And mm-hmm. I'm talking about worrying from, is my hair okay today?
Right.
You know, does this shirt really match with it?
And right.
Like, are you serious? We're having this discussion right now. To worrying about her children, worrying about her health, worrying about her finances, worrying about this one little leak that she sees in her roof, and, you know, the whole roof's going to cave in.
That's interesting.
And I'm like, yeah, you're a hypochondriac. Mm-hmm. You're just mm-hmm. fearing and worrying about the
worst. Well, that's how a lot of people bring on a lot of diseases and disorders
Absolutely.
In their bodies. Because we'll call worry warts.
Yep.
And I guess because one of the things is, if you don't have the peace of God on you, then you're going to worry.
Right.
Because I was a worry wart.
Right.
I was one of those. I mean, I remember years ago, and I would sit at a desk, and I started noticing it, and I'd be on the phone, and sometimes you'd be on, you know, talking, but your mind be somewhere else, and by the time I was finished, that whole paper would be just full of,
like doodling?
Doodling.
Doodling. Oh, wow.
Doodling. I realized that it was, my mind wasn't focusing, and I was worrying about, there's all these things that are on your mind. You can't shake it. You can't get it off of your mind. You're constantly thinking, it's just something that just takes you there.
Right.
You don't even know how to get out of it or come out of it. For instance, you're talking about worry. You may worry about your finances
mm-hmm.
or worry about, you know, your spouse in some situation, and you just can't shake it.
Right.
You're worrying. That's why the Word of God says, cast all your cares on me, for I care for you.
Absolutely.
Because worry really is a sin.
Mm-hmm.
That's what started
fraying. Because you don't have any faith and no trust
right.
that God is going to...
Mm-hmm.
Then
know.
When I realized that that was a behavior that I was operating in, that was a sin, which is really falling short of God's will, mm-hmm. God's best.
Right.
That's when I started praying against it, because I realized I was just worrying about things. I would just be doodling and thinking and mm-hmm. worrying. And I couldn't shake it. I don't care what it was.
Right.
You know, whatever it was, I just literally could not shake it until I realized that that was not of God, and then I had to get that thing off of me.
Right.
And somebody that's controlled like that, like your coworker,
mm-hmm.
like, we have a relative that's like that. Just
mm-hmm.
I mean, and it seems so silly to me, but to her, it is so
real.
It's
a big deal. Exactly.
She comes to our house,
yeah.
and she worries about whether the kids get out the door for school.
Mm-hmm.
And she'll lay awake for like hours in there worrying whether or not the kids are going to go to school or not.
Mm-hmm.
And I will have already taken the kids to school, and I'll be back home, and she's still worried. Well, did they make it to school?
Yeah.
Well, did the kids get out the door?
That's a spirit.
Well, I've just been laying awake worrying, and I'm
did
like...
Did somebody come and shoot up the school? Did they throw grenades
yeah.
and bombs?
That's,
and
yeah, that's,
like,
a, that's
why
definitely...
Why would she be worried about that? That's, you know,
yeah. That's definitely
gone.
A spirit
that takes
of...
That takes a toll on
like
your cardiovascular
oh,
system, and, you know, you... Over pumping all this
that's,
blood that doesn't need
yeah.
to
that's
be
beyond,
in your heart.
That's beyond worry. That's fear.
Yeah.
It ties
well, it does.
Flows into each other because you start to worry and then you start getting scared and then you get
yeah,
anxious.
That's what happened. She started in worry
mm-hmm.
and she's now walking in fear.
Yeah. Or if she gets a piece of mail in the a letter in the mail that she doesn't understand it. It could be something as simple as explaining her health care. She starts worrying about it,
right.
and she'll call me and say, oh, my heart's just been racing since I got this. I'm going to read it to you, and you try to explain it to me because I don't understand what it's saying. And
yeah.
then I'll explain the whole thing to her, and I'll, you know, tell her, don't be worried
mm-hmm.
about this.
Right.
Yeah,
or she'll
definitely.
say it's the 18th of the month. Mm-hmm. She has a bill that's due the 15th of the next month.
Right. She'll worry about
she
it the whole month?
She will worry the whole time about getting that bill in on time.
Wow.
She'll say, well, I can't come down to your house because I got a bill due on the 15th. I'm like,
yeah, just crazy.
That's
stuff.
Like weeks yeah. away.
And see, we may sometimes we think it's, you know, they crazy. Laugh and silly or whatever, but
it's real.
You know, it is real. People are paralyzed and cannot enjoy the fullness of life because they're
exactly.
so captivated by these things.
I think if I really believe this in my heart, but I believe if we don't really come into that saving grace, that's where a lot of people are. That's where a lot of people are going to go deeper into mm-hmm. it because that's the world we're living in. Mm-hmm. Who is the God of this world?
What does the Bible say about men's hearts,
failing
them,
for fear.
In the last days?
Yep, exactly what's happening.
Men's hearts will fail them for fear.
Fear. And because if you don't have the mindset of Christ, you mm-hmm. have the mindset of the systems of the world, well, who is the God of this world? So if you're not believing in the absolute truth, you're not believing that God is able, you're not believing that all things are going to work for you, not against you, if you're not believing those things that are good, pure, perfect, lovely, and a good report, because mm-hmm. you're only going to act on what you believe.
Right.
And when you say what you say, because you're believing what you say. I don't know what I'm going to do. I just can't take this any longer. These kids are driving me crazy. Mm-hmm. Oh, my head is hurting every day. Well, we're speaking those words, mm-hmm. words that are bringing.
We're speaking death and not
exactly.
life.
There you go.
Like that's in the power of
life
the tongue.
Yeah.
Right.
Right. So we don't realize we're operating in spiritual dimensions, mm-hmm. whether you know it or not.
Right.
Lack of knowledge is what causes us to have issues and problems and perish for a lack of knowledge. It's really even, I call it rejecting knowledge now. Some mm-hmm. Bibles call it rejecting because there's a whole lot of knowledge out here. But we reject it because we don't act on it. Mm-hmm. See, we have to act on truth.
Yes.
In order to get... Mm-hmm.
Change the way we're talking. Even I tell people, even if you only get one scripture that speaks about what you're going through,
very good.
Say that one scripture over and over and over.
Absolutely.
You don't have to learn
Absolutely.
A thousand scriptures
That's
about
exactly
your situation.
Right.
Exactly.
God has not given me a spirit of fear,
right.
but a power, love, and a sound mind. If you speak that every time you're feeling the
that
fear,
is so
God
true.
Hasn't given me a spirit of fear. God hasn't given me a spirit of fear. God hasn't, you know, until...
Because you're... Now you're speaking words of life. Now
yes.
you're speaking words of deliverance. Now you're speaking words
works.
Of freedom.
The word of
it.
God
right.
works.
It will change your life. Now, tip these topics that we're talking about, fear, worry, and anxiety, they all have to do with our mental state of
yes.
mind.
Exactly what it is.
And
mental
a lot of times
status.
People who are dealing with all three of these are people that are also suffering from depression because these bring heaviness and a feeling of hopelessness.
Yes.
And
but it goes
you
into
just
a
begin,
deeper,
it goes into a deeper mm-hmm. level. Mm-hmm. And even though it begins in the mind, it has to be fought and has to be broken in the spirit. That's
yeah.
where it needs
Got to
be. Fight.
Yes.
And those folks that are constantly, you know,
and
entangled
it's,
in
it's a lack of It's a lack of knowledge
right.
that they don't know.
Exactly.
And somebody with the good news of the gospel goes and tells them.
Exactly.
I never forget the time I was getting anxious about something. I was really getting like, it was really bothering me. It was like, oh my God. And I'm like, oh, geez. And that scripture, be anxious for nothing. But in everything in prayer and supplication mm-hmm. in the spirit, let your request be known unto God. Mm-hmm. I said, okay, be anxious for nothing. Be anxious for nothing. Thank you, Lord. And I just kept, you know, praying and thanking God mm-hmm. because I acted on what God said to do. Mm-hmm. And the peace came.
Right. Yes.
Cancel out the anxiety. Canceled mm-hmm. it out because I just choose to go God's way. See, and just when you spoke the word, what's that scripture? A word spoke fitting apples.
A word fitly spoken is like apples of gold and pictures of silver.
Mm-hmm. And sometimes people need that, you know, when you worry, have mm-hmm. anxiety, fear, and then somebody comes and speaks the words of life, speaks the words of healing and deliverance. Mm-hmm. But they have to, in some way along the line, learn how to speak that into their own lives as well. But mm-hmm. somebody comes to bring healing, deliverance, and freedom. Because the words are power, life, and death.
Right.
As a man thinketh,
So is he.
Absolutely. And the Word of God tells us not to worry.
Right.
It actually says the words,
don't
worry.
That's what freed me because I said, I always thought worry was just a part of...
Fear not.
Right.
How many times is that
right.
in the Scripture?
Right.
Fear
exactly.
not.
Fear over 300 and some times.
Yeah.
say it in the word.
Mm. And my coworker, you know, when I bring it to her recognition, I have brought it to her recognition that you are worried about things you can't control, that this is gripping you and stopping you from experiencing life, she blames it on that, you know, she doesn't have any control over it. Oh, I've just always been this way.
Yep.
This is just the way I am. Mm-hmm. And so me being a person who had been delivered from depression and oppression, all three of these mm-hmm, things, mm-hmm, for
sure.
more than 20 years of my life, mm-hmm. I'm sympathetic to her. So I'm always constantly ministering to her. And for me to have, you know, to break free from that mental torture that was in my mind, my favorite scripture, and I can't remember what the scripture is, but I know you ladies know it. Take every thought captive. Every mm-hmm.
thought
captive.
To the obedience.
Pulling down
yes. of pulling down of the stronghold. So that gave me the revelation
yeah.
that I don't have to just entertain
pull
whatever comes in my mind. Mm-hmm. I don't have to just mm-hmm. sit there and dwell on whatever thought just drops into my spirit. I can take that thing captive,
exactly.
cast it
yes.
out, bind it up so that, you know, I'm sitting in my rightful position. I have the authority in Christ Jesus.
Right, exactly. Mm. And that's
Hallelujah.
The thing. What Absolutely. We lack of knowledge and what we don't know is what really hurts us.
Absolutely.
You know, God can get somebody to bring you the good news, but then we have to act on it,
mm-hmm.
you know, because we, even as Christians, we'll go through. There's
right.
things that I could still, you know, I'm like, because I had, it was the other day, it sent me some kind of a bill from the hospital. Mm-hmm. I'm like, I had my peace. Because I could have went there.
Yeah, you could have sat there and let that ruin
but
your
I
whole
let,
day.
Yeah, but I didn't. Because, see, then I began to hear what God wanted me to do.
Mm-hmm.
I did everything he told me to do. Not only did they pay the whole thing, they even owed me some co-pays.
Hallelujah.
They sent me checks in the mail.
Oh, my
yeah.
goodness. They paid you.
Yeah, they started paying me. Because he told me what to do. And I began to act on, you know, and I just took my time. Because I used to like to take care of things right away.
Right. Yeah.
Deal with
oh,
it.
Oh, right, right, right.
You know, that can cause anxiety. Mm-hmm. That can cause worry. But I wouldn't, you know, wouldn't go on them because I wasn't going to pay it. Because
mm-hmm.
I already knew they was out of order.
Mm-hmm.
That I did know. I didn't know nothing else. They weren't going to have, they had the wrong sister. But I had to learn patience to do it the right way.
Because you can't hear the wisdom of God
right.
if you're anxious, worried, and afraid.
Right. right. You can't.
You
right.
can't. And
because you start doing everything your way.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And the wisdom of God is peaceable.
Right.
It's gentle. It's easy to be entreated,
right.
which
Without
means
hypocrisy.
You're in a state of peace.
Right.
Yep. That's
and
what I had
And you hear
to
the
do.
Voice of God. You're in a state
that
of peace.
Priceless.
And you hear the wisdom of God. You
yeah.
hear what you're supposed to do, how to go about it.
That's right. Exactly what he did. Showed me every
life.
Single step, who to contact, who to talk. I'm like, and the next thing I knew, everything was just dealt with. They owed me money. I mean, like, I'm saying, God,
wow.
thank you, Jesus. See, old me would have probably messed it up, got all upset,
mm-hmm.
whatever.
The checks,
yeah, messed everything up. That's why.
Checks.
That's why he says all things kind of work for you,
right?
You know, because I knew it wasn't right, but a lot of people will accept what they don't know as right, and then they get stolen from.
Mm-hmm.
But if you know,
exactly,
just. Acknowledge God. You know, sometimes the Lord will let you know something's not right. You may not know why it's not right,
mm-hmm.
but if you tap in, he'll lead you out of that thing.
He'll
into
give you that unction that it's
yeah.
not right.
Just
yes.
asking him,
yeah.
show
yeah.
me, let me know what's going on here.
Right.
Let me know. And he
and
will.
Just be patient with it.
Because, right.
you know, it took me a minute or two. I said, okay. All right. And then he told me exactly which way to go, who to call, what not to do, what to do. I said,
right. But if your mind is so boggled
time.
Down, again, like you said, with
yeah.
fear, worry, and anxiety,
yeah.
you can't hear the direction
exactly.
of the Lord. You can't feel that unction because your mind is
right.
so,
racing.
You know, it's racing. You all you hear is the loud
right.
lies that are
yeah.
in your mind.
That's
you
exactly
can't get right.
You got
when you're hearing all of that all the time.
You act upon
Calm
the
down.
Lies.
Yeah. Right. You
that
do
you're
act
hearing,
on it. Yeah.
And not the truth.
You make a
whatever.
Greater mess
yeah.
than what you
make
had.
Decisions based off of the lies. Exactly.
Yeah. And that's exactly how the enemy wants you to do it.
What about anxiety?
You know, I was thinking about a personal example of anxiety,
mm-hmm.
and I thought to myself today, well, I've never really been anxious, and it just came to me sitting here, yes, I have. Years ago, when my oldest daughter was a teenager,
mm-hmm.
I went through a period of anxiety where I was even hospitalized.
Oh, wow.
Because she was very rebellious
mm-hmm.
and was... I never knew for one day than the next what she was going to be doing. I was a single parent.
Mm-hmm.
It was just the two of us. And she would do things like staying out all night. I couldn't find her, didn't know where she was. I'd take her car away from her and hide it places. Mm-hmm. And it was just a mess. And I remember going into the hospital, and I didn't know what was wrong with me, but I had the heart racing, mm-hmm. the heart palpitations, mm-hmm. I had the shallow breathing, and they ran all these tests and couldn't really find out what was wrong with me. And we went to actually I stayed in the room with you. We went to the Legends.
Right.
You remember that?
Yeah, I remember. You
remember how I was sick and I'd mm-hmm. have to stay in the room?
Right.
And I didn't know what was wrong with me. And so this one day we were down at dinner. It was a staff getaway thing. And I got the shallow breathing, and I just got a phone call from Gabe. Mm-hmm. And she had stayed home alone because mm-hmm. she was around 16, mm-hmm. 17 years old. And I didn't know whether she came home at night. I didn't know what she was doing because
right.
she was just kind of doing her own thing. Mm-hmm. And I was sitting at the table, and I got a phone call, and immediately that shallow breathing
came
started.
Back up. Wow.
So Pastor Faye was watching mm-hmm. me. And she said to me later, "Judy, I believe I know what's wrong with you." And she said, "You are having panic attacks mm. and you're having anxiety."
Right.
And I didn't know that's what it was. And I would have times where I'd even have to take my clothes off. I'd be
sweating and perspiring.
I'd break into a sweat. Mm. I'd feel like I couldn't breathe. I'd be just feel like I was getting ready to die.
Right.
It happened
right.
there
yeah, yeah.
in New York.
Yeah.
I went in the bathroom. I remember they took my shirt off and they were fanning me and mm-hmm. put splashing water yeah. on me. And it was all anxiety. Now
right.
that is clearly an attack from the enemy.
Yes.
There is no way God wants you as a child of God living
right.
in that state
exactly.
of mind.
Not at all.
But I was there. And I remember going to the doctor and saying, "I need something." Now there are many people that take medicine for anxiety mm-hmm. and honestly there's nothing wrong with that. If you're going through a period where you are not functioning,
right.
where you're overcome with anxiety,
mm-hmm.
there's not a thing wrong with taking something mm-hmm. to get you through that
right.
that period
exactly.
of time.
Right.
So he gave me Paxil. And the first time I took it, I felt like it numbed all my emotions, and I felt like I wasn't even a person. I couldn't mm-hmm. feel anything.
Wow.
And I thought, I can't live like this. Wow. So I began to just pour into the Word of God. Studied every scripture I could find on anxiety, panic attacks, and I would quote them and quote them and quote them, and God delivered me out of that.
Yeah.
Because I decided my answer has to be in the Word of God.
Absolutely.
And not in the medication or...
Right. That'll help you and sustain you till you get the spiritual revelation.
Exactly.
Right.
So I always call the medicines like the law. It keeps you until you get the revelation.
Yeah.
But those so many people are dependent on, and they think that there is power in that pill, and that mm-hmm. you know,
they have to do
some
it
people do have to
lives.
Do it.
They
you know,
to.
If you have,
yeah,
some
yeah,
people have to. But there are some
until,
people. There are a lot of people on
until
it.
Until you get the revelation of, you know, you get the manifestation, should I say, even of the healing
mm-hmm.
or what God can will you know do, and you know, you don't want to just have faith in, and there's something that's going on unknown to you.
Exactly.
That can be
that
dealt with in
medical
the natural
attention.
Right.
until you get
yeah.
the revelation and the insight. Just like, you know, you did with, you know, you did what you had to do, and then you, of course, got the deliverance through the Word, but mm-hmm. you kept doing what you had to do until you got that.
Until I
absolutely received
just sought God
yeah.
with all my heart, poured into the Word of God, because I thought, I cannot go on like this.
Right.
I cannot live like this.
And it may take a minute or two for that to manifest. So
mm-hmm.
you keep doing what you know to do
yes.
in the natural so you can get the supernatural.
Exactly.
So we didn't give the definition of anxiety just for, you know,
oh, yeah.
you already medically think
exactly.
that people may know, but there may be somebody who doesn't know. But it says here, anxiety is a feeling of worry. So it's a spinoff of worry. It's a feeling of nervousness or unease, typically about an intimate event or something with an uncertain outcome.
So really, fear, anxiety, worry, they all kind of work hand in hand.
Yeah.
One spins off mm-hmm. of the other. But the anxiety is it's a feeling
right.
that you get.
Right.
And signs of it are a pounding or racing heart,
mm-hmm.
sweating or cold, clammy hands,
anxious.
Feeling jumpy or restless,
mm-hmm.
trembling, twitching, shaking.
Wow.
And I think about that loved one I was telling you about that gets so worried, and she shakes constantly.
Right.
Just shakes
shaking.
Constantly.
Yeah, that's definitely. She developed a spirit.
Yeah.
That's what that
it's
is.
It's definitely something that controls
Yeah, because
her.
After a while, you keep doing the same thing over and over, and you That's a knowing.
It goes away.
Knowing.
Yeah. Yeah, because like some of those symptoms you mentioned, that's how I felt when I first started doing the show with you.
Yeah.
Is she reading the definition of how I felt when I joined the show a year ago? Or public speaking. A lot of people
don't
hear
yeah.
public speaking.
Until you do it.
How are they going to perceive?
See, it's almost like you
got to
break that
me.
Thing by
yeah.
doing it.
Over and over.
Because I remember the first time somebody asked me to minister for more than 15 minutes. I'm sorry, I ain't got nothing else to say. 15 minutes. Now you can't shut me up.
Oh,
so that's good.
And that, I think that's kind of normal to have those
it
feelings.
Is, yeah.
Of, oh, I don't, you know. But it's when it controls you,
yeah, like your
yeah.
or family
immobilizes
member.
You.
Mm-hmm.
Where
yeah,
you
when it controls you,
where you
yeah.
don't get up and speak,
right?
You're
at
so
all,
afraid.
Right? Yeah.
You know,
then you just mess your whole.
You don't come on this show
right,
you're so
because
you're
scared.
You have like social. You know, I don't know if you know of anybody that has like a social
yeah.
phobia, social anxiety.
Yeah.
They don't want to come out the house.
Declusive.
They don't right. They
yeah.
seclude themselves because
they feel
they,
like people are watching them.
Right.
Yeah.
They're fearful
them,
and anxiety, and they yeah. That is
paranoid.
Paranoid.
Yeah. CO, yeah,
having a hard
things.
Time catching your breath,
mm-hmm.
Feeling a fullness in your chest or throat. Now, I've had that where
wow.
I felt like just a tightness
well, like
come
the
over
cat's
me.
Got your tongue. I can't.
Yeah, just like yeah. a, I don't know, it's a feeling where you just feel like something's clogging
right.
you up. Like
right.
you can't,
wow.
you know. Feeling dizzy or lightheaded, having stomach aches or nausea. Mm-hmm. Having trouble falling asleep or getting a good night's rest because you're so anxious. Now, here's what the Word of God has to say. I just pulled out a few scriptures about it. Because when you understand that God has really, there's commands
mm-hmm.
about it. Because
okay.
He says, be anxious for nothing.
Right.
Now, that's a commandment of
pretty
God.
Pretty point
is.
Be anxious for nothing. But in everything, by prayer with thanksgiving, you said it,
mm-hmm.
Let your requests
spirit.
Be made known unto God, Philippians 4.
Because it tells you how to, as well as how, don't, yeah. this is what you do.
Mm-hmm. And it's so simplistic. He said, don't worry about it. Don't be anxious.
This is what you do
talk
to stop
to
it.
Me by prayer mm-hmm. and by supplication.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
With thanksgiving.
With thanksgiving. Let everything
Father,
be
thank
made known.
Father, I thank you, Lord, that all worry and all fear and all anxiety is no longer part of me. Because you are the greater one that is in. If you're talking like that, you're talking the words of God, that thing, the spirit cannot be in dwelling place where
absolutely.
You are entering
mm-hmm.
into your secret place with
and
the
if
Lord.
If you don't know how to do it initially, you know, some people are like, well, I can't pray like you, and I can't pray like a pastor, mm-hmm. I can't pray like this person. Begin. I mean, there's so many free resources,
absolutely.
You know, on church websites, on YouTube, about topics like this. And you can download and listen to word mm-hmm. and scriptures mm-hmm. about fear, worry, and anxiety.
Even
and
if
as
you're
it
just
be-
whispering it.
Oh, absolutely.
You know?
Can, you know, I'm a firm believer, like, you know, some people say, I can't turn my brain off at night. It just keeps going and going and going. So everything I've been worried about during the day, you know, robs me of my sleep. Put some earphones in. Listen to some meditation scriptures. You know, let the mm-hmm. Lord cradle you and rock you
yeah.
off to sleep to turn that brain off.
Good old songs, you know.
Yes.
Yeah.
You know, just really whatever that's coming out of your mouth mm-hmm. is coming out of the radio, the social, whatever. Words of life. Words that bring healing, words
right.
that bring deliverance. You're putting something in to root out something.
Absolutely.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
So you want to, like I said, when I first started walking in the things of the Lord, I remember, like, I would get these thoughts. They were nice thoughts, you know, somebody said something, just something. I was like, and I knew they weren't godly thoughts.
Mm-hmm.
So So I'm like, what do I do about that? And this girl told me, I was telling you all, you know, the thing told me, Mary, you start getting those thoughts, you just bind the devil. Just bind him in the name of Jesus. I said, okay, I can do that. So I got this thought one day, and somebody said something, and I was like, I said, in the name of Jesus, Satan, I bind you right now, you foul work of darkness. And I just said, I bind you in Jesus' name. And that thing just thought just left me.
Just melted like off of you.
I said, I'm not like that. It really
works.
Because I wasn't, all I was doing was getting these thoughts and I didn't know how to deal with it. And that's why I think to today, I always want to tell people the how to.
Mm-hmm. Right.
It is not just, I'm not going to tell you all that God did and not tell you what your part is. There's
mm-hmm.
a part that we play.
Exactly.
In order to receive.
Yeah.
Either we're going to say it, we're going to believe it, we're going to declare it, decree it, we're going to pray it, we're going to act on it. Mm-hmm. You know, it's something that we do to open up to freely receive what's freely ours to be had.
Right.
And God is not going to disappoint us because he's not a man that should lie. He's the God of his word and his promises.
Right.
So if we act on the word, it says, be anxious for nothing. You said to be anxious for nothing. But in everything in prayer and in supplication in the spirit, you let your request be known unto God in all thanksgiving. Well, you do that part.
Right.
And once you do it, that thing has to bow because the greater one is in you that's now coming out of you, speaking, whether you're speaking it, listening to it, even listening, even just hearing it. Because what you hear inevitably is what you're going to start believing.
Exactly.
And you're going to act on it. Now, I tell people all the time, you be around certain people, you'll start talking like them.
Mm-hmm. Acting like them.
Yeah, acting
like them. You do. Yeah. You pick up their
little sayings, little slogan. You know, so-and-so says his best is just not good enough.
For me, in dealing with, you know, in my state of depression and dealing with these, you know, three topics, there was just one day I just got sick and tired. I said, there has got to be another way. I'm tired of feeling low. I'm tired of being scared, worried, and anxious. Something has got to give. So that other scripture that says, you just said it a little while ago, speak those things as though they were. So I challenged myself and said, okay, if I speak my mind whole, it should be whole.
That's right.
If I speak and cast these thoughts down, they should be cast down. Mm-hmm. Even if I don't feel it initially, even if it doesn't go away initially, if I keep at it, eventually my words will replace my thoughts.
Exactly.
It's going to line up with the Word of God.
Was it trace it, erase it, and replace it? It's like somebody knocking at your door and knocking at your door and knocking at your door and you don't answer. What's going to happen? Inevitably.
They're going to go away.
They'll go away.
That's the same thing with thoughts, with the accusatory of the brethren. And he giving you these, and you say, no, they ain't God. They ain't God. God's blood,
like
that
a
ain't.
Cesspool. It's
yucky.
Yeah. Yucky stuff.
And we still, because he's always trying to give us these negative thoughts and attitude. And we know, number one.
Job.
Yeah. So we got to be able to say, you know what? I'm not receiving this thought because it's not of God.
Mm-hmm.
And I reject it. I renounce it. And I will not tolerate it. I will not entertain it. So you have to take your authority. That's what taking authority is.
Yes.
It's taking authority is knowing who you are in Christ, speaking out until that thing realizes you're no joke.
Right.
You will bow in this temple because you are not allowed. You have already been exposed. You've been brought down. So you are a false entity and you must go in Jesus' name.
You don't have to
you
be a victim.
You speak those and call forth, like you said, those things that be not. Father, I thank you in the name of Jesus how you set me free, how you delivered me, how you send your son Jesus over 2,000. You know, just speak words of life, words. You can make up your own words as long as they're biblical and they're according to how the word says it.
Right.
You don't even have to say thus, though, and thou. You don't even have to listen to write your own, is what I'm saying.
Mm-hmm.
You write your own. You don't have to even listen to somebody else's declaration.
Exactly. With that word.
That's all it has to be.
With the word of God.
Just write your own little thing out. You talk out of your heart, the heart of God. You know, just, Father, I thank you that you have freed me over 2,000 years ago, Father. And you know what will happen? I'm telling you what's going to happen. The Holy Spirit will bring words to you that you will bring out of your own mouth to bring the freedom and the deliverance and
you'll
the liberty.
Be surprised. Did I just say that?
Exactly.
Or it might be a song.
Thank you. It might be even a song.
Sometimes God speaks to me with a song. He'll just suddenly put a song in my heart, and it just deals right with what
I'm experiencing. You feel that peace just
instantly
wash over
and
you.
And you know, this came from God.
It's just acting on the word.
You don't have to sit there and allow, like you just are defenseless against the tactics of the enemy.
Right.
We are more powerful in Christ Jesus when we stand up and take our rightful position and say, devil, no more.
Mm-hmm.
Christ died over 2,000 years ago for such a time as this.
Yes.
That blood is powerful and can get rid of fear and can get rid of anxiety and worry.
And if you feel overbearing or overburdened, should I say, in such a way, and God's going to give you, because he's going to give you that way of escape. He's going to give you a thought. Like we said earlier, we have to have that inner peace to even receive it. He may say, call so-and-so. That might be the person to help you up and help you out to push you where you need to go. Because sometimes, it's, I always explain it like this. Sometimes I say, one of the girls tell me I'm really heavy. I'm just, you know, and I knew she needed to be talked out of that mess and prayed out of that. And but I said, you know, it's okay, because I remember years, for I was not for years, I would, but for a long time I was sat and under the word, and I was really heavy, real heavy. But I just kept coming and listening, and it's like that thing just, you know. Mm-hmm. I said, and what happens is, it's like something heavy is on you, and somebody's got to help lift that thing off of you, because it's just too heavy for you by yourself.
Right.
So you get, God sends you help,
yep,
and lifts it off of you, so you can at least get up, mm-hmm, and start. Mm-hmm.
Which this says, 1 Peter 5, 6, and 7 says, an anxious heart weighs a man down, but a kind word cheers him up.
So sometimes that other person speaking into your life, that word fitly spoken, just breaks it, lifts it off of you. I remember I went to the hospital to visit this guy, and didn't know him from A to Z. And one of the offices that I worked with asked me to go and visit his father. And at St. Francis, I didn't know him. And I went to the hospital, and I said, oh, Mr. So-and-so? He said, yeah. And out of the clear blue sky, I just looked, and I said, well, your son asked me to come up and pray with you, and God's going to set you free today. Mm-hmm. And he just burst out in tears.
Oh, wow.
Just started crying. He got delivered. I didn't even say nothing. Mm.
You said something.
I mean, I did say something, but I mean, I was like, God
didn't have that revelation.
Word.
God was going to set him free.
Yeah, God was going to bring, I said, deliverance. God's going to deliver you today. Yeah. And he just started crying.
Which shows how powerful your words are.
Yeah.
They can lift a person out of the deepest depression.
Right.
Just by speaking the right word to them.
And a lot of times people think that they are by themselves in this state of mind. I just wanted to share some statistics just about how many people are just, you know, in bondage to these things. When it comes to fear, nearly 6.3 million people are diagnosed with some type of phobia or related fear in the U.S., according to the Brain Research Institute in 2016. You know, a percentage of these things that are feared will probably never happen, about 60%. Percentage of things feared that happened in the past is about 30%, and a percentage of things feared that are considered insignificant, about 90%.
Wow.
Percentage of things related to health that will probably not happen. You know, people worry about their health. I'm having a heart attack. I got cancer. I got this. I got that. 88% of it is just not.
Not even the truth.
Not even. And for anxiety, according to the National Institute of Mental Health, including generalized anxiety disorder, they call it GAD, panic disorders and social anxiety, 40 million American adults 18 and over are sufferers, known as the most common mental illness out there.
Wow.
So there's a lot of people that need to be healed, set free, and prayerfully there are some people that are listening or viewing this message tonight, or will look at it, you know, in the archives, and realize that they don't have to be,
live their life like that.
Absolutely.
And the Word of God says, don't worry about your life.
Don't worry.
What you will eat, what you will put on. Don't worry about what you're going to wear.
Mm-hmm.
Some people, you know, they're anxious about everything. What am I going to wear tomorrow? Lay awake thinking about, okay, what am I going to wear tomorrow? What am I going to eat?
Right.
Or your body, what you're going to put on. Consider the lilies of the field. They don't even toil, and God takes care of them. Consider the birds of the air. God takes care of them and feeds them.
Mm-hmm.
So
how much more?
How much more will he take care of us?
The word is, if there's anybody watching right now, I'm going to just say this prayer. Let them also be praying with us. We're going to say it. We're getting ready to close out, but I want the Lord to put it in my heart that we should all say this together.
Okay.
So we'll just repeat this with me. Say, Father, in the name of the Lord Jesus.
Father, in the name of the Lord Jesus.
I thank and praise you.
I thank and praise you.
That you have not given us a spirit of fear.
That you have not given us a spirit of fear.
But a power.
But a power.
Love.
Love.
And a sound mind.
And a sound mind.
Perfect love.
Perfect love.
Casts out fear.
Casts out fear.
Anxiety.
Anxiety.
Worry.
Worry.
Any kind of torment.
Any kind of
torment. I'm made perfect in your love.
I'm made perfect in your love.
Father, I thank you.
Father, I thank you
that you've given me, the authority, over all the enemy.
Over all the enemy.
You said, nothing by no means, would hurt us. Therefore, I put my trust, in you.
In you.
I'm not anxious.
I'm not anxious.
I'm not worried.
I'm not worried.
I'm not fearful.
I'm not fearful.
Allowing anything.
Allowing anything.
anything to overwhelm me,
to overwhelm me.
Try to abort your plans for my life.
Try to abort your plans for my life.
Your purpose for my life. You said in Isaiah 41:10. Not to fear. For you are with me. And I'm not to be dismayed. For you are our God.
Who strengthens us.
Helps us.
Upholds us.
With your righteous hand.
With your righteous hand.
Father, I thank you.
Father, I thank you for your son Jesus.
That has been made to us.
Peace.
Because I'm not afraid.
I refuse.
In the name of Jesus. To allow fear, worry,
or anxiety
to ever control my life. I choose to guard my heart. Focus my mind
on
what is truth.
In the midst of uncertainty.
And when Satan tries to come to attack me in my mind
with negative or diabolical
thoughts, even when I feel afraid,
I believe
that you are with me. And no weapon formed against me
will prosper.
I am totally convinced
that nothing
can ever separate me from your love. Neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor demons, neither fears, worries, torments, anxieties, cares, lack, sickness, evil, calamity, or anything trying to overwhelm me.
Even when I'm afraid,
I believe that you're with me.
I thank you, Father.
You have graced us for whatever we face.
Therefore, we live courageously,
fearlessly,
in this life,
by the power of God that rules and reigns in our lives.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Well, thank you, Jesus. And we want you to know that you are graced
for everything
you face. Amen.